Hi there, I'm nicodehaan and welcome to Living a Primal Lifestyle. Coming at you from deep in the mountains of the San Juans in Durango, Colorado. That's where we are. This is where we explore a return to a more balanced and natural wild world.
To recover our natural health and regain our rights and freedoms. I'm Ellen DeHaan.
Man, it's a beautiful day in Durango, Colorado. Right now it is 71 degrees and going up to 82 with a low of 50. These cool nights have been really, really nice.
Yeah, open the windows and the doors.
Please subscribe to our YouTube or Odyssey channels. Hit the follow button, hit the like button, and help our channel grow. We also post on Facebook and LinkedIn for your convenience. And hit the link below the show notes to maximize your nutrition with products from Mother Earth Labs. These are the products that we use to supplement our diet. And we also look at the mainstream news stories about anti-aging, natural health, history, climate, as well as our freedom. And we do our own analysis, which you should too. So all the topics for today's show are in the show notes with some videos listed below in the description. So you can follow along. How are you today?
Oh, I'm doing very well.
Oh, good. Yeah. That's a gorgeous day
here. Getting ready for our trip.
That's right. We got a trip at the end of September, going back to Florida.
One more time,
at least, anyway. So let's start with the new, let's see, this one comes from The Guardian, September 5th, 2023. No more cordon bleu.
Cordon bleu.
Cordon bleu, yes.
Yeah, it's obviously a play on cordon bleu.
I think so. So France tries again to ban meaty language on vegetarian products.
Apparently the country had previously banned some use of the words, the references to meat to describe non-meat products.
Yeah, well, I've kind of complained about that too.
Yeah, well, wait 1 second.
Sure.
However, there was a 2020, vegetarian, vegan folks sued them.
Yeah.
And the court, 2022, there was a decree that protected those words. And it was suspended by the country's top administrative court.
Mm-hmm.
So now it's being appealed now to the European Court of Justice so that they can see whether they'll be able to ban it at all.
Well, it's just not appropriate.
In the meantime, you were saying?
Well, I was thinking of things like steak fries. There's no steak in those fries.
No, but that's an expression that refers to some very thick and large fries.
Yeah, so they do have a name. Yeah. But, I mean, there's no buffalo carrots and stuff like that. So, I mean,
No cattle carrots.
Farmers and firms in France's meat supply chain have long militated against terms like plant-based burger or vegan sausage, claim that they confuse consumers. I don't know if they really confuse people, but it makes them feel maybe a little more fuzzy that they're eating the right thing. I don't know. It's very confusing why they would want to do this.
So the country has now, in the meantime, while they're waiting for the European Court of Justice to make a ruling, they've created a new, kind of modified their language a little bit, and they've applied it only to products made and sold in France.
Yeah.
And then they banned a list of 21 meat names to describe protein-based products.
Plant protein-based.
Yeah, it just says protein-based, but it's a plant.
Like including spare ribs, ham, butcher.
Yeah, you don't butcher vegetables.
Although they may be crying, as we found out before.
Yeah.
However, over 120 meat-associated names, such as cooked ham, poultry, sausage, or bacon, will still be authorized, provided that the products do not exceed a certain amount of plant proteins, with the percentages rating between 0.5% or up to 6%.
Yeah.
And this reminds me of like some of the burgers at the fast food places, which contain soy.
The Impossible Burger.
Well, that's completely plant-based, they've always been putting some soy.
Filler.
Yeah, fillers in things like that.
Well, ground beef has always had fillers in it. And we just all assumed it had fillers in it. And nobody thought too much about what they were. What they might be. I mean, every once in a while you'd get 100% ground beef.
Right.
But ground beef is ground up with other things. So
yeah,
in fact,
there's a certain percentage that you can put other plant-based stuff in ground beef mm-hmm. and still call it 100%.
Yeah, right.
So it's, mm-hmm. the decree will come into force 3 months after publication to give operators time to adapt their labeling. It also leaves open the possibility for manufacturers to sell all product stocks labeled before the entry into the force. So
before the law goes into force.
Yeah, so you don't have to print labels immediately.
Right. But at the latest, 1 year after the publication of the decree.
Yeah.
It's interesting.
And that's going on in France, but it may be also going on in different places. Not in America, as far as I know.
Number two, do vegans kill more animals than meat eaters?
Well, I've always contended that when you start planting crops in a wild area, then you're going to kill the indigenous population.
Well, you'll certainly impair their ability to thrive because you've taken up their natural environment and changed it.
In fact, I've told this story before, but a horticulturist, when I worked for waste management mm-hmm. in the pest control area, he came in and did a talk, and he says, if you take 10,000 acres, you put a road right in the middle of it, you automatically kill half of the indigenous animals that are there, mm-hmm. just because of that. Hmm. So planting, of course, disrupts everything. The animals that live in a forest are not going to live
in a meadow. Or in a field,
especially mm-hmm. if it's being cultivated. Mm-hmm. And I think the biggest example of that right now is the Amazon. Mm-hmm. You know, they're knocking that down to plant crops or just for grazing animals. Mm-hmm. When we know in Colorado here, the animals graze up in the mountains. We don't need fields.
Right.
So the animals find a way to find what they need to mm-hmm. sustain themselves. Mm-hmm. And that whole picture of the Midwest with thousands of millions of buffalo running all over the place. Nobody at that time was complaining about them. Walking? Yeah, roaming.
Roaming
is that.
Yeah, the right word.
Yeah, I mm-hmm. think it is too. Mm-hmm. But
And this article, I mean, I thought, okay, this should be interesting. So I'm reading, the question is, does a vegan diet lead to more animal deaths than an omnivorous one? Is it true that harvesting crops for vegans kills more animals than farming grass-fed beef? And it says, talks about veganism as a concept, says it's all about causing the least amount of harm possible.
Right.
So, but according to a recent article, due to the processing of harvesting crops, vegan and vegetarian diets actually carry a higher body count and environmental costs than their omnivorous counterparts. So.
But it's probably not the animals that we're thinking of. They're talking about rodents and things that. And small
field
animals,
mice, you know.
And maybe even insects. But insects actually probably grow.
Well,
because if you're planting a field, it's easier for insects to say, hey, here's a field of
the
locusts come.
Different insects than you would have.
Yeah.
And there's a balance in nature. Insects are there for a reason. Even though we may not like them much, but in some cases, like mosquitoes or something.
But if you plant a huge, huge field of something, the insects that are attracted to that are different insects than would be living
would
in
live
a forest.
Right? That's right. Yeah. That's right. So it says, it's important to note that the researchers' arguments hinge on the comparison of pasture-fed cattle to field animal deaths from grain harvests. And they're comparing the most ideal practice of raising cattle to the least ideal practice of harvesting crops.
Right. So if we're talking about grain-fed, now we're planting crops, not just for human consumption,
to
feed the animals. Uh-huh. When the animals will... and then this is because we fence them in, right? So we want them
they can't go and forage for themselves.
Right. Although in Colorado, they do that.
Yeah, there's a lot of open range. Throughout, it's not just Colorado. Oh, yeah. There's open range in Idaho. There's open range in Utah.
And
Mexico.
I think some of the Midwest, too, is now considering opening up those range lands for the animals to forage, too. So and then this also brings to mind the discussion about, the cows farting and, things
methane.
Like that. But nobody's complaining about the deer farting.
Mm.
I mean, if it's ruminants that are doing this, then all ruminants would be doing this, right? But
we keep saying when millions of buffalo roamed the plains, there was no methane problem.
Well, at least that didn't, nobody complained about it being contributing to global warming, let's say.
There was nothing. There was no issue.
Right. Yeah. And it may be that the cows fart more when you're feeding them grains, right?
Because that's well, we all do.
Yeah, I mean, exactly.
Grains are so inflammatory and they inflate you, they bloat you, and I'm sure there's more gas produced when, as a human, you're trying to digest the bread or the cereal or the pizza dough or whatever it is.
Well, they do mention in this article, setting aside the fact that the overwhelming majority of meat produced in the world is grain-fed, 97% of U.S. and ever-growing internationally, a fact which is completely invalidates the entire arguments of omnivores causing less harm.
So then,
and that's, I can see there that point there. Yeah. So our contention is that let them not eat the grains.
Yeah, exactly. And so the article goes on to say, well, let's look at the viability of grass-fed cattle as a primary source of protein. Mm-hmm. Pasture-raised livestock is not the idyllic picture of environmental sustainability that's so often painted by its advocates.
Yeah. And of course, maybe cattle isn't the right thing that we should be promoting. We should maybe be promoting more wild type of game.
Yeah, but, you know, they talk about all this, all these free-range cattle and so on. And it's like a grass-fed cow. And it says one grass-fed cow requires anywhere from 2.5 to 35 acres of land, depending on the quality of the pasture. U.S. alone is close to 100 million cattle, which, if using the conservative estimate of 2.5 acres, means 250 million acres of grazing pasture, which is over 390,000 square miles, more than 10% of the entire U.S. However, the article then goes on to say, regardless of these statistics, the fact remains majority of the meat consumed by non-vegans is feedlot meat. So they're not out there taking up 10% of the land.
No.
It's a very, very small percentage.
Right, but the feedlots are the problem, right?
More than 90%, yeah.
But it's not just the problem for this particular issue. It's also a problem for our human health, right?
Oh,
and the health of the animal.
My goodness, yes. I mean, right. And then there's the antibiotics and the hormone shots and everything they give them, because when they're in the feedlots, they're standing in a foot of manure and they're
squashed together and not as much room to move.
Diseases.
Yeah. It reminds me of that picture, I think it was in Sweden, where after a hard winter, they let the cows out of the barn and the barn animals are just jumping for joy and, you know, rubbing themselves on the grass. I mean, it's a great picture. Understanding that these animals love the outdoors and confining them is just cruel punishment. Even though in the wintertime, you probably want to protect them, right? So there is that.
Yeah,
but the wild animals seem to survive.
What did buffalo do when the snow came in the plains?
They huddled together.
They had ways of dealing.
Sure.
So it says, let's see, the feedlot meat requires an insane amount of crops to produce and places the additional death of field animals on top of the toll of direct deaths by non-vegans. Non-vegans are not excluded from consuming grains directly. And, of course, you feed grains to the cattle that are in the feedlots.
Well, if you're eating a hamburger, it says here that, too, you've got two layers of the bun, right?
Right, which is
grains.
Grain.
Yeah, but not all vegans eat grains.
Oh,
there's
right.
There's a lot of people, that just eat vegetables and starches and potatoes and things like that.
Mm-hmm.
And grains are really a problem that we've done away with pretty much. 99% of our diet is no grains at all.
Right.
And that's because our joints hurt when we do eat them and lots of other things.
I have arthritis in my fingers
problems.
That I completely control because I don't eat grains.
Yeah. So there's a lot of benefits
I mean, what it comes down to is the people who endorse eating meat versus the people who endorse not eating. And it's the same argument, and it just goes round and round. And no matter what you do, you're impacting the planet. No matter which choice you make, you're impacting the planet. You change the balance of the biology, the bias, what is it called? The
biosphere.
Yeah. Well, anyway, you change the whole balance, and no matter which way you go.
Sure. Agriculture and both domestic animals do that also.
Right. Yeah. So it was just interesting to look at the article.
Yeah. Next article is about natural immunity, and it says here, and this is an opinion piece, it says natural immunity.
Comes from the Washington Post, September 15th, 2021.
Yeah. Natural immunity to COVID is powerful. Policy makers seem to be afraid to say this.
And it's kind of a summary of some of the studies that have been done, and it says you can have an incorrect hypothesis. However, if it gets disproven, you need to acknowledge that and move on.
Yeah, it says, unfortunately, many elected leaders and public health officials have held on far too long to the hypothesis that natural immunity offers unreliable protection against COVID-19, a contention that has been rapidly debunked by science. And we've always indicated that it makes sense for natural immunity to be superior to everything because that's how we evolved.
Yeah, I was just thinking about it this morning and thinking, I never got a measles shot. I never got a mumps shot. I never got a chickenpox shot. I got the measles. I got chickenpox. And then I'm done.
Yeah, pretty much.
You know, we didn't have it when we were kids. There were no vaccines.
I think we got maybe three or four shots.
Yeah,
and now
whatever it was, yeah. And more when I was in, probably the ninth grade is when the sock vaccine became available against polio.
Wasn't that an oral?
Yeah, it was an oral. Yeah. It wasn't actually a vaccine because a vaccine is injected or maybe it's just something that's made a certain way. Yeah. We took it on a cube of sugar. It was a drop of...
Yeah. So more than 15 studies have demonstrated the power of immunity acquired by previously having the virus. A 700,000-person study from Israel 2 weeks ago found that those had experienced prior infections were 27 times less likely to get a second symptomatic COVID infection than those who were vaccinated.
And then that confirmed a June Cleveland Clinic study of healthcare workers who were often exposed to the virus, in which none who had previously tested positive for the coronavirus got reinfected.
Yeah, the study authors concluded that individuals who had SARS-CoV-2 infections are unlikely to benefit from a COVID vaccination.
Yeah, and then in May, a Washington University study found even a mild infection resulted in long-lasting immunity.
Yeah, downplaying the power of natural immunity had deadly consequences. In January, February, and March, we wasted scarce vaccine doses on millions of people who had previously had COVID. If we had asked Americans who are already protected by natural immunity to step aside in the vaccine line, tens of thousands of lives could have been saved. This is just not hindsight, it's 2020. Many of us were vehemently arguing and writing at the time for such an irrational study.
Of course, since that time, the studies have also shown that taking the shot probably didn't make any difference in either direction and didn't save lives and
didn't stop your neighbor
the infection
from getting it
and didn't stop the spread.
A lot of things like that. And in fact, I remember Biden coming out a couple of weeks ago. He says the new boosters, this time they really work.
No.
Which is kind of admitting
that they didn't.
Didn't before, in a sense.
And they don't work. I mean, it's...
I don't know.
There's no change. Well, let me put it this way. There's no evidence. There's no data to back up anything.
Well, in fact, the next article is actually a video... Mm-hmm. With one of the doctors that has been studying this, talking about there is no medical data for these boosters at all.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, exactly. And that's the concern, you know.
So
do we want to keep on putting stuff into our bodies if we don't even know if it does any good?
Well, it's just people are so skeptical now. A lot of people, I certainly am, of these companies putting out these things strictly for profit, having no idea whether they're actually helping us or not helping us. And it's very concerning, I think. So people really have to make up our own mind, and that's what we've always said. We need the information, give us that, and then let us make up our own mind.
But there's no, well, we're not getting the information that we need. I mean, the pharmaceutical companies just don't release it, or they don't.
It's mostly propaganda.
I would expect them to be gathering the information, but I don't think they're ever going to release it.
I don't know.
But it's interesting because this article does say that last week on CNN, Anthony Fauci, who they claim is the nation's top infectious disease specialist, hinted that the government may be rethinking its stance on natural immunity. And he was quoted as saying, "I think it's something we need to sit down and discuss seriously."
Yeah, he's always saying we should have a discussion on masks again, too. Mm-hmm. So, you know, I mean, we've known a lot of these things work very limitedly. Mm-hmm. They don't seem to work much at all, especially the masks that we get. Maybe if you get a surgeon type of N95 mask, you might have some kind of.
Well, that's for really for bacteria, not for viruses.
Yeah, though. And the bacteria are larger. We know that.
Yeah, those masks are made to stop bacteria. And in both directions.
A lot of people have a contention that viruses really don't exist at all, right?
Yeah, well, that's a whole different discussion.
Yeah, yeah.
Now, it's interesting because when we're talking about the non-mRNA vaccinations, the old ones like chickenpox, in this case, they said, the CDC has long recommended that kids do not get the chickenpox vaccine if they had chickenpox in the past.
Yeah, and that, I think, applies to measles also.
Oh, I'm sure. I mean, that's just one example.
Yeah, because we know all about the chickenpox parties that people used to have to get their immunity
When you went to the first grade or kindergarten, you assumed your child was going to get the measles.
Yeah, or the chickenpox.
Any of those childhood diseases that were going around.
Yeah, and that would make you immune to some of the more serious diseases like the shingles.
Well,
it's the same.
Zoster virus.
Yeah, it's the same thing. Mm-hmm. So the incorrect hypothesis that natural immunity is unreliable has resulted in the loss of thousands of American lives, avoidable vaccine complications, and damaged the credibility of the public health officials.
So we'll have to see how it goes. There's already lots of conversation going on out in the world about whether or not they're going to require. Los Angeles school system just recently said everybody over 12 has to have a vaccine if they want to go to school in person.
Right.
So we'll see.
Yeah, so that next article is the fall of the COVID-19 booster is a public health fiasco. Check that out for yourself.
It's We're a not video. Going to go through
it. Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's a video, so check that out. Mm-hmm. The next one is how unique immune cells can recognize and destroy tumors. So this is, again, about the mechanism that how immune cells can actually work and how they work.
How they work, yeah. There's been a lot of studying about a special type of cell in the immune system called gamma delta T cells. And they know that these cells are incredibly effective at recognizing and killing cancer cells. And cancer patients with higher levels of these T cells in their tumors tend to fare better than those with lower levels. But they couldn't figure out how they worked.
Yeah, but scientists have struggled to understand exactly how the gamma delta T cells can recognize these cancer cells and how new cancer therapies may be able to take advantage of these powerful immune cells. So this is the study that's going on here.
Yeah, it says T cells are a type of white blood cell responsible for recognizing trouble in the body, from invading viruses or bacteria to cancer cells with genetic mutations. There are billions of T cells patrolling your body. They have a protein on their surface called a T cell receptor, and that recognizes molecules on the particular target cells.
Yeah, many experimental cancer treatments are being studied today, trying to re-engineer T cell receptors so that the T cells can better target tumors.
Yeah.
So if they're already doing a great job of it, why do we
have to? Well, we want to enhance it, or we want to be able to to maybe, if you don't have enough of these cells, maybe be able to add them to your body. That's the key here. So the researchers have used CRISPR technology, which of course is gene manipulation,
right,
to disrupt thousands of genes in lymphoma cells and systematically test which gene disruptions affect whether or not the gamma delta T cells are killing cancer cells. And they confirmed...
Well, at a molecular level, the conditions needed for gamma delta T cells to identify and clear cancer cells are still unclear, making it difficult for scientists to envision ways to boost this process.
Well, they said that the gamma delta T cells were recognizing a complex of molecules called butyrophilins,
yeah,
which were previously shown to be targeted by the gamma delta T cells, but the molecules are found on the surface of many human cells, both healthy and diseased.
Yeah, it turns out that just knowing what gamma delta T cells recognize was not sufficient. We needed to know how this process is regulated and what makes them different from other
in some
cancer cells. So
yeah,
they don't really know how it works yet, but they're just kind of working on it, I guess.
Yeah, so now they were looking at... They did manage to confirm that the hyperactive cholesterol production, which was a common feature of many rapidly dividing cancer cells, led to the activation of the butyrophilin complex, making it accessible to those T cells.
Yeah. When they looked more closely at the results from their CRISPR screens, the researchers found that gene deletion that cause cellular stress and depleted energy production in cancer cells made these cells more likely to be killed by the gamma delta T cells, also increasing the amount of this
butyrophilin
molecules at the surface of the cancer cells.
So they took that insight and they showed that when tumor cells from cancer patients are treated with the drug that mimics the cell's stress response, the tumor cells are more easily recognized by the T cells and have an increase in the butyrophilins.
Yeah. Now, we read an article, was it the other day, that we were talking about that the increase of people getting cancer below the age of 50 has been rising up to like
84% higher this year than it was last year?
In the last 3 years.
So
this has this to do with the COVID pandemic? Has it to do with us being shut in and not going out in the sunlight? Has this, you know, what's going on?
Yeah.
Has our food changed that much? We know a lot about cancer being produced in the body because of our diet.
Mm-hmm.
And we know that the worse
and
your
the
diet
environmental
is.
Contributors to the diet.
Because of the different chemicals that
right.
we're constantly exposed
mm-hmm.
to. So. There's a lot to...
We'll keep an eye on that one and see if we come up with an article.
So it just shows you how important it is to eat properly, not use chemicals as much as possible. We know that we've started not washing our hair with soap anymore, not using soap on a regular basis. And I have really noticed the difference in the last month
mm-hmm.
of how I feel, how my skin feels, mm-hmm. how my hair feels.
Dry brushing.
Yeah, doing dry brushing and different strategies to keep yourself clean. And we've noticed there's no odor, no
mm-hmm.
nothing going on here.
Mm-hmm.
So a lot of the stuff that we've been told that we need to buy and use may contribute to
a lot of the problems. Are full of chemicals because they've got all kinds of different things you can't pronounce. If it's more than three syllables and you can't pronounce it, you know, it probably isn't good for you.
Yeah.
And then even on the botanicals, I find that I can't use most of the botanicals because for some reason, the natural ingredients give me a rash.
Yeah.
So... It's just, that's just my personal biology.
Yeah, and also I've noticed my skin was a lot drier when I used soap.
Yeah, the soap actually dried it out. Here we are trying to moisturize our skin by using good soap or, you know,
using things after the soap
to
moisturize.
Well, but I have shower gel that has no soap in it.
Mm-hmm.
but my skin was still drying.
Yeah, and my hair was very, very dry, where now it's completely different. So there's strategies that we can use to help, that's for sure. And it's been working, which is nice. Okay, let's go on to this.
This is home insurers cut natural disasters from policies as climate risks grow. And, you know, I remember starting with Hurricane Andrew in 1992. In the aftermath of Hurricane Andrew, there were a number of insurance companies that withdrew from Florida. There were secondary mortgage, secondary insurers that weren't able to sustain the losses. They got out. Yeah, and some of the large companies had pulled out for a while.
And they actually made a new company called Citizens,
state,
right?
The state of Florida formed a company called Citizens Insurance. And at one point, about 5 years ago, Citizens Insurance was the largest insurer in the entire country, which is, it was supposed to be an insurer of last resort for those people who really couldn't find insurance. And then Citizens stopped insuring coastline properties, you know, by where there's storm surge and lots of damage. And now here we are, and then we had Irma.
In the aftermath of these extreme weather events, major insurers are increasingly no longer offering coverages that homeowners in areas vulnerable to those disasters need most.
I think I have I have a major problem with the headline. Because I don't think it has anything to do with climate risk. It has everything to do with financial risk.
Good point.
You know, it's not, they're not pulling out because there's global warming. They're pulling out because there are too many claims and they're not making the money that they used to make.
Well, I was looking at Progressive site. I was looking at the stock exchange site. And in the last 3 years, they made $100 and some billion profit. So that's not gross, that's net. So I think these insurance companies are making money, but I think they're fearful that
well, they're not making it, they have to count out to their shareholders.
That too.
And the shareholders are expecting a certain return. Yeah. And if the insurance company isn't getting that return, that's going to be a problem for the insurance company from a financial perspective.
So the major insurers say they will cut out damage caused by hurricanes, wind, and hail from the policies, underwriting property
along the coastlines.
Along coastlines and in wildfire country, according to a voluntary survey conducted by the National Association of Insurance Commissioners, a group of state officials that regulate rates and policy forms.
So at least five large property insurers, including Allstate, American Family, Nationwide, Erie Insurance Group, and Berkshire Hathaway, have told regulators that extreme weather patterns caused by climate change have led them to stop writing coverage in some regions and to exclude protections from various weather events and raise monthly premiums and deductibles.
Of course, while we lived in Florida, we saw our rates going up and up every year. I think the last year that we had a policy there, we were paying somewhere along $3,500 a
year. For our house insurance.
And that was based on the value of the house, where the new insurer we figured out was going to be paying more than double that because he bought the house at a much higher rate than we bought
the new
house.
The
new owner, So, I mean, this is serious. It's not only that, are there taxes going up because of that same thing?
Well, Farmers Insurance pulled out of Florida.
Right.
And the other big insurance company, a lot of small ones have pulled out.
But what are they going to cover now? Just somebody tripping on your sidewalk?
That's liability insurance. That's not even the same insurance. You know, we're talking about what they're talking about is taking the windstorm policy and making it more comprehensive and it's always extra. You have to purchase a separate policy. It's not included in your homeowner's policy. You have to, and it's, they're raising the prices on all of those policies. So if you want to, you can buy that insurance. It's going to cost you a lot of money.
Yeah. And always irked me, too, that the flood insurance policy, I mean, if you're living, like we live 65 feet above sea level, so we never needed flood insurance.
In Florida.
Mm-hmm. But if you lived on the coast, you had a subsidized flood insurance.
National program.
A national program by the government. So it would be cheaper And to me, that never made any sense.
And you could also, but you could also purchase additional. You couldn't, for a long time, you could not purchase additional flood insurance. Then eventually individual homes, like in a condominium, each unit could purchase
a separate,
additional flood insurance.
Yeah, but that was only, it would only kick in if the other flood insurance
once, the other was primary.
Yeah, but in other words, if an insurance company, a private insurance company like Allstate, went into an area that was on the coast, it would be very, very expensive for flood insurance because that place floods. Right? Yeah. You're in a flood-prone
but
area.
But Allstate is not providing flood
insurance. No. So we have this national policy, which makes it much less expensive. And who lives on the coast? The people who have the most money.
Or not. I mean, what we saw on Irma was, for example, in the Florida Keys, the people living on the coast were living, some of them were living on boats and little houses, you know, whatever you call them.
But once the storm goes through, that's
they
likely
lost their homes, they lost everything, you know, they had nothing. And they abandoned the Keys.
And I'm sure a boat isn't covered by
all that. Allstate said its climate risk mitigation strategy will include limiting new, that's auto and property, new policies in areas that are most exposed to hurricanes and implementing tropical cyclone and or wind hail deductibles or exclusions where appropriate. Now, the windstorm deductible for like my clients is something like, is between 5% and 10% of the total appraised value of the entire property. So you have, you know, you could have a couple of $1 million, $5-6 million worth of value, and 5% of $5 or $6 million is still a very high number of dollars that you have to come up with before the policy even kicks in.
Yeah. And then the coverage isn't that good. Mm-hmm. This reminds me of like if you have auto insurance and they say the exception is if you get hit by another car, we're not going to cover you.
Right.
You know?
If you have a steering wheel, we don't cover you.
Yeah.
We have to read all that small print. It says, and then Nationwide also says that it no longer underwrites coverage for properties within a certain distance to the coastline because of the hurricane potential. And then this was
exposure.
Kind of a staggering... Yeah. Some staggering information because Hurricane Idalia is not even finished yet.
Yeah.
You know, and it says that it brought severe flooding to Georgia and the Carolinas and tore through parts of Florida that had never experienced direct hits from a major storm. Yeah. Tropical Storm Hillary caused $600 million in damage on the West Coast, according to a leading catastrophe modeling firm. And the fires on the Hawaiian island of Maui, whose cause is still under investigation, led to $3.2 billion in property damage. You know, I forgot what I was going to say. Go ahead.
Well, the natural catastrophes in the first 6 months of 2023 in the United States caused $40 billion in insurance losses. That's the third costliest first half on record.
Yeah, I remember what I was going to say.
But if you just take that Progressive insurance making $140 billion and they're losing $40 billion over all the insurance companies.
Right. It's not really a significant hit. It's a staggering amount of money. But the thing is that, insurance is not local. It used to be that, you know, they would take what goes on in Florida and use that as a model for how to...
All of Florida.
For all of Florida. Right. Now, insurance is global. And if the fires are in Maui and the fires are in California and the floods and the devastation from the recent deluge of rain and the Hurricane Hillary stuff... And then the Hurricane Idalia, Hurricane Ian, all of these things that go on, it matters. It doesn't matter where you live. You're going to be impacted by any amount of money that gets paid out in a different, totally different place.
Yeah.
So it says, typical home insurance policies cover damage from all manner of perils, including fire and smoke, wind and hail, plumbing issues, snow and ice, vandalism and theft. Floods are generally covered by the separate program.
Yeah, it says under policy changes, many large insurers are reporting to regulators that firms will continue to offer baseline policies to clients in disaster-prone areas, but without protection for damage caused by those disasters.
So we'll insure your house, but if it burns down in a forest fire, too bad it's not covered.
That's right, or a hurricane.
Oh, man. Yeah. And it says, for example, a policy in a region affected by hurricanes may exclude coverage for wind or hail damage. You know, again, windstorm is a hurricane is a windstorm, and it has a separate policy. So virtually all homeowners' policies exclude coverage.
Yeah, somebody throws a rock through your window, you're safe, but otherwise.
Yeah, well, no, you have to buy a separate policy. That's the key.
Yeah.
So.
It says at the end of this, says major hurricanes are becoming more frequent and hold more intense rains. A climate scientist from College of London says.
Imperial College.
Yeah. Meanwhile, Tornado Alley, an area swarmed by twisters that runs from Texas through Oklahoma, Kansas, and Nebraska, is moving east.
So yeah, that was an interesting
story. Yeah, they've been talking about that for the last few years, mm-hmm. and because of
the tornadoes in Kentucky and Tennessee.
Yeah.
And, you know.
We've always had that. In Michigan, they had tornadoes, mm-hmm. and we certainly
Florida
have
certainly has tornadoes.
Yeah. Anything else you want to discuss here? When you see the insurance companies pulling out in mass because of the cost of rebuilding homes in Florida, is bankrupting them. He says it's either
hubris
or folly to think that the state won't be bankrupt stepping in to help.
Yeah, it's the state of Florida is in precarious position financially anyway.
Well, we looked at this data before we left Florida, and one of the reasons of leaving, it's not the only reason, but the costs were getting higher. Mm-hmm. We got tired of the hurricanes. We knew that they were going to be more frequent, and we wanted to live in a climate that was a little bit better for that, and this is it for us. So,
yeah, it's interesting.
I think we moved at the right time, babe.
Well, we did for so many reasons.
Yes, that's true.
The Citizens was set up so that every insurance company that was licensed to do business in Florida paid a certain amount of money to Citizens.
Right.
And that's where they created their reserve from which they were paying claims in addition to the premiums that they were charging.
Well, the whole concept of insurance was really about like a small community. The barn burns down or blows down. The whole community comes together and rebuilds it.
Helps you rebuild
mm-hmm. it. Nobody's asking for any money. In fact, they have a little party. You know, we bring the food and we bring the drinks and we build a darn thing and everybody goes, hey, thanks a lot. And that's it.
Mm-hmm.
So that's the way we used to handle it in the old days without insurance companies, right?
Yeah, right.
Is this any better? I don't know. You know, we have a lot more people now, a lot more expensive homes. It's hard.
Well, plus everybody's on top of everybody, and it's not like you were in the middle of a field and, you know, could limit the damage.
In a community like ours, here we have like 250 homes or so like that. If something drastic happened and we were cut off from everybody else, we could see the community come together and helping each other rebuild.
Yeah.
That's the way it was.
Mm-hmm.
It's not going to happen anymore, though, especially if you're in New York.
Majority of the world.
Yeah. Okay, let's go on to the next. And this is interesting. Opposite don't attract. Couples are more likely to be similar than different, a study shows. Yeah, that makes sense to me.
Yeah, they say, you know, that old saying, opposites attract, and you look at people.
I think they're talking about magnetism, perhaps.
Yeah, right. Yeah, because, you know, when you see couples all the time and they get along great and they're very similar, you know, it just seemed to me. So it says the power of animal magnetism has brought countless couples together. When it comes to who we fall for, scientists say there is little truth in the old adage that opposites attract.
A study on romantic relationships found that more than 80% of the traits analyzed, from political views to drug taking and at an age at which people first had sex, partners were often remarkably similar.
Yeah, I think if there's too much diversity in, if you don't have some basic concepts and some basic foundation values that are similar, that you share, Yeah, you're not going to be able to maintain the relationship.
Right, if you don't like the music that your partner is playing on the radio in your car.
Yeah, right. It's going to be a point of contention.
Turn that rap off, please.
Yeah,
and well, although some of the rap I...
Well, let's not get into that.
Okay. No, I'm just saying, you know, we've gotten used to some of it, and some of it is not that
well,
bad.
Well, we like what we like, and every generation has a soft spot for the music they grew up with.
Yeah, we love the 60s and 70s, right? And some of the 80s.
Yeah,
and you get into the 90s, then...
Well, we don't need to critique music.
No, we don't.
Okay. According to research, between 82% and 89% of traits examined were similar among partners, with only 3% ranking as substantially different. Now, yes, there are going to be some differences. You don't have a person who's a clone of you.
Well, it says here couples did not match on every front. Height, weight, medical problems, personality traits all varied among couples. Extroverts, for example, were no more likely to partner up with another extrovert than introverts, right?
Yeah,
that makes sense.
Yeah, so it's
although I've seen that in couples where the guy is really quiet and the woman is jacking her head off.
Or the man.
Or the man, perhaps, you know, occasionally.
Oh, jeez.
Then you just turn this off.
Okay, turn it off.
I don't always silence this.
Yeah, I forgot to remind you. Yeah, there have been many times when you've looked at, certainly more than a few times, you've looked at a couple and thought, yikes, you know, how did they get along? By the same token, it does say that romantic partners often share core core beliefs, values, and hobbies, and relationships based on common ground can arise when people grow up in the same area, socialize with a narrow group of friends, or grow more similar.
The longer they spend together.
And I mean, it talks about...
I mean, some of the things that you were exposed to and I never was exposed to, and then we start talking about it, we agree on.
Yeah, or we find that we did have similar experiences. They weren't exactly the same.
Right.
But they were... But, I mean, and the other thing is that one of the things that we do very carefully and very intentionally and mindfully is support each other.
That's true, too.
So, you know, if you have something, if I have something I really love to do, you're going to support me in it.
I'm going to go for it.
You know, and you have, off-roading is a good example. You absolutely love off-roading.
I do.
And I've been on, the only two trips I've ever been on since we've been together that I wasn't on were the last two. And those were, you only have two seats in your car.
Yeah.
And we have some friends who had asked if they could go and have the experience, and you've been kind enough to take them off-roading.
Yep.
And that's nice for me because off-roading is not a passion of mine, but it's a passion of yours.
Right.
So I want to support.
Well, there's part of it that you like. You like the scenery.
Oh, I like a lot of it. You know,
it's just not the bouncing around that
certain,
you like that
certain
much.
Trails I'm not fond of.
Yeah.
That's all.
Or some extreme ones around here.
Yeah, yeah, or the idea of being on a ledge road and having some three other cars coming up the other direction, and it's only a one-lane road, and there's no road on
the
side.
Yeah, and you have to figure out what to do from there. Yeah.
Right. But the point is, even if you don't exactly, like, I love to do jigsaw puzzles.
Mm-hmm.
And you enjoy doing jigsaw puzzles. It's not something you're going to think of automatically as something.
The only time I really did it is when I moved to a different area, didn't know anybody. Mm-hmm. I just got a puzzle.
Yeah.
And I'd watch football or something like that, mm-hmm. and have the puzzle in front of me,
right.
and worked on that.
Yeah.
And that's the way I got through kind of the period of loneliness,
mm-hmm.
maybe.
Mm-hmm.
And I do enjoy it. Once I get into a puzzle, I'm
mm-hmm.
there.
Mm-hmm.
But I don't think of it as, oh, I'm going to go spend a couple hours doing a puzzle.
Yeah, I use the jigsaw puzzle as a way of keeping my brain sharp.
Yeah, yeah.
My eye-hand coordination,
mm-hmm.
and seeing shapes and... And I enjoy it very much, and I could spend hours doing that if I'm not careful.
Yeah. And I do jujitsu, which is a puzzle in itself,
that's
too.
Right.
So, you know, that keeps the same
different
process
kind.
Going.
Mm-hmm.
Yep.
Yeah.
So, next article is, this is interesting, that African elephants, they say. I don't know about the Indian elephants, but
they use names
for each other.
The study was done in African countries.
Yes, first outside of humans. And this might translate to other animals too. When they grunt in a certain way or bark in a certain way, that may indicate that they're calling their buddy or something like that, or their relative, or maybe this, it says here in this article that they communicate because often they don't, they're out of sight of each other.
And yeah, the elephants tend to roam enough space, but they want to keep in touch.
Yeah, so. And they have these low grunts and noises that they make, and they have found hundreds, and it says here the first database contained 625 separate calls, 597 of which occurred between members of the same family group.
There were 114 unique callers and 119 unique receivers. And the researchers were only looking at calls that seemed to be directed at a single individual elephant and for which the receiver could be identified. And they found that, yes, they could. They could see
pretty
who
interesting.
Who
of course,
did,
we know that elephants are very social, very protective of their young. They move in herds. They're intelligent animals, for sure. Yeah, so this is really something. One aspect the team was particularly interested in is whether the calls mimic the receiver's own vocalizations. This had been observed in other species, such as dolphins, which can learn each other's individual vocal labels and respond to in their own vocal labels when they hear it.
Yeah, so in other words, it's like they hear... They speak a certain way. They have a certain tone to their
inflection,
and so on to the sounds they make.
Kind of like and babies when, cooing and stuff like that too.
Well, know? It's in this case we're talking about another animal recognizing your voice, basically.
Yeah, which is like the baby gets used to the mother's voice and probably the father's too, but the mother's more intently, right? That comfort, that security, that the baby
familiarity,
gets, familiar, knowing that the person is there in the same area with you. Because the baby, the only thing the baby can do is use their diaphragm and cry, right, at the beginning. And then they start cooing and doing other things, which is pretty cool, too.
Yeah.
Anything else you want to say about this?
No, I just thought it was, you have to wonder. Who's funding research these days?
Well, this is more that I like to see, this kind of funding.
Oh, sure. Yeah, this is interesting. This we have such a anthropological bias to humans are the only ones who talk, and you know,
well, we're the only ones that are really intelligent. I mean, there are intelligent dogs.
Well,
and
it's
monkeys.
Our intelligence. That doesn't mean that you know. They say that an octopus is a highly intelligent animal.
Very problem-solving.
They say, you know, dolphins do a lot of things. Yeah. There are lots of animals on this planet that could give certain humans a run for their money.
Definitely, especially in groups.
Yeah, I mean, it's just to think of those very large animals and how they communicate with each other and how they manage to stay in their herd and... You know, wander off, but be within calling distance, as it were.
Yes, as all elephants are often out of sight of their closely bonded social partners and produce contact rumbles to communicate over long distances.
Yeah, it's very interesting.
Yeah. Also, they say vocal labels could enhance coordinating ability while out of sight of one another.
Right. Say, so meet me at the creek. You know?
Meet me under the banyan tree. Yeah. Okay, last article here, very interesting. I had no idea that humans had a third row of teeth.
Apparently there's a potential. It says following up on a 2021 study that showed how medicine targeting the protein synthesized by the USAG1 gene could impact the number of teeth grown in animals.
Now the team has turned to a human clinical trial. By using the USAG1 gene, researchers believe they can help people with a full set of teeth regrow teeth.
Apparently, the human body has a potential to grow, because teeth are so important to your survival, I would assume, that there are buds that are sort of dormant.
Right.
You give your baby teeth, and then you lose those, and you grow your adult teeth.
Yeah. course, me being born during the Second World War in Holland, my parents, of course, were heavily, and the whole population of Holland was deprived of food, of good food. So they started using what they called starvation foods, which are grains,
rice, my dad had potatoes.
To go, when I was in my mother's womb, then my dad would have to go and get some milk from the farmer, which was miles and miles away.
On his bicycle.
On his bicycle, yeah. So that's the story that they told me. But my parents lost, and everybody in that whole community lost their teeth. So when my parents, already before we moved to Canada in the 50s, early 50s, they already had lost their teeth, and they were continually buying different dentures and things like that. So the starvation food that humans have always gone to were the breads and the grains, because you could store them for a long period of time and hide them and things like that. But the other stuff really wasn't available because you were in a war zone. So there was
plus there were no dentists, no regular cleanings, no regular no regular care.
But that's been
disputed. Did you brush your teeth? I mean, did you have toothpaste even?
Oh yeah. Well, I don't remember when I was six years old if we were brushing our teeth, but when we came to the United States, I remember having doing that for sure. Yeah. But as a result of that whole thing that my parents didn't brush their teeth, I was pretty lax at it. You know, they had their dentures that they put in, they were good to go. Of course, the dentures were in a solution to clean them and things like that. But so the stress really wasn't on us to brush our teeth that much. Maybe just because they weren't doing it themselves. I don't know. But I don't know. But anyway, it's an article that this is pretty interesting, following up on a study in 2021 that showed how medicine targeting the protein synthesized by that USAG1 gene could impact the number of teeth grown in animals. The team has turned the attention to the humans. So, now there's a 2024 clinical trial that they've announced, which they hope to be ready for general use in 2030.
I mean, they're looking at the, there are people who have lost all their teeth and, you know, through, for illness or
malnutrition
or
whatever. Accidents.
And he said they're looking to see if there's a tooth regrowth possibility. It's besides dentures and implants.
Right. And each of those have their own problems. You know, if you got a bridge, then you have to clean under the bridge, and you have to be very vigilant. If you've got implants, then you have to, you know, clean around the implant too.
So anything that's in your mouth because of the bacteria and the food and things.
One of the things that helps us too with our teeth is the oil pulling. It really makes a big difference cleaning your teeth. And that's a subject we'll get into some other time, but we've talked about it before too.
So they're, they've had very good success in mice. Now they're trying to get to people and see.
Well, we know that certain animals do regrow teeth, like sharks. And I had no idea that we had third row sitting in there, and you wonder if that was an adaptation that kind of went dormant.
Well, I think, as I say, I think it was something. I'm going to look at these last two paragraphs in the article here. It says about 1% of humans suffer from anodontia, which is a genetic condition that doesn't allow a full set of teeth to grow. So they're looking at maybe being able to get teeth to grow and for those people. And then he said, the researcher says, we should be further encouraged by the fact we already come preloaded with the starting point. In his previous research, he found that humans have the start of a third set of teeth already embedded in your mouth.
This is most visible, exhibited by the 1% of humans with
hyperdontia,
which is the growing of more than a full set of teeth.
And so the researcher believes that activating the third set of buds with the right gene manipulation could promote teeth regrowth. Very interesting.
Yeah. Well, maybe we can regrow some brains in some of That might be the next.
Well, step. You can grow a brain in, but that doesn't guarantee intelligence.
Yeah, that's true. True.
Or critical thinking or anything else, you know.
Yeah.
It's tough. The human body is an extremely complex organism. There's so many things. It's always amazing to me when a baby is born completely healthy. It's like so many things have to go right for that to happen.
Yeah. And we've done it for millions of years. Yeah.
Exactly.
Pretty amazing.
Yeah.
Well, that's our show for today. Thanks for sticking around, folks. Hope you enjoyed it. Please subscribe to our channel. Hit the like button. If you have any questions, you can email me at nicodehaan@me.com or leave a comment below the show notes in YouTube or Odyssey. And mm-hmm. we'll be sure to answer them. Thanks a lot.
Be well.
Bye-bye now.